The Toronto Blue Jays had reached the summit just 1 year ago. Now in their quest to return, they featured a new cast. Veteran blood, men who knew how to win. Men with reputations for coming up big in big games. Consummate professionals. As the season went on, they added the most feared leadoff hitter in the history of the game. This savvy leadership meshed with a 24-year-old 19-game winner and a man who flirted with 400 much of the year. They held off one challenge after another and reached their desired goal.
And the 1-2 pitch to him. Ground ball for Tony Fernandez. Alomar for one. Ori for two. Double play. That's the ball game. It's a 93-peat. The Blue Jays are champions of the American League East again.
In 1992, the Philadelphia Phillies finished dead last in the National League East. Now they were healthy. They were called throwbacks to another generation, a modern-day gas house gang. They had long hair, beards. They jumped out to a big lead, and they had fun.
You see anything growing yet?
Oh, it's a huge difference. Take it down. Check out the...
But this cast of characters also had character, plus a leadoff man with MVP credentials. And they would go from worst to first in the course of 1 year.
Ground ball, it's fair ball. Kroc to Paul. The Phillies are the 93 National League Eastern Division champions.
Two divergent teams with the same objective, to win the 1993 World Series. The road to the World Series would take Toronto through Chicago, and to guide us through the American League Championship Series, Toronto pitcher Dave Stewart.
Going into the ALCS, we felt pretty confident that, you know, we'd have a real, real good opportunity to win against that ball club. We knew Jack McDowell was pitching the first game, which, you know, he's no slouch, but we had good success against him. He pitched well for about two or three innings, and then, you know, we started to chip away at him.
Runners at first and second and two out now, and Ed Sprague steps into the box. And he swings at the first pitch, down the right field line, Burks back to the warning track, crosses his glove. This will get Olerud home, Molitor around, he will score, and on his way to third is Ed Sprague, 2-0 Blue Jays. Olerud goes, the pitch is hit high and deep in the left center field, Johnson back to the wall, and it's gone! Paul Molitor, two-run homer to give the Blue Jays a 7-3 lead.
And a 7-3 victory. Then in game two, with the Blue Jays leading 3-1, Stewart, who was 6-0 in his LCS career, faced a bases loaded, nobody out, sixth inning situation.
Dave Stewart is at the 100 pitch mark right now. Bases loaded, nobody out.
At that point, if I let them score as many runs as they could have possibly scored, which would have been four, then we're out of the ball game.
Into short center field, Devon White is there, and the runners will hold.
I knew that was a key situation in clutch time in the ball game.
Popped it up. Sprague for out number two.
I haven't been that excited in probably years. It was really, really an exciting moment for me. That's why I wound up running the ball to first base.
3-2, two out, runners go. Up the middle, and Stewart makes the play and will make the play at first himself and works his way out of the inning.
I got back to the bench. Everybody was standing up, high-fiving, and Molly had said that, you know, there were a couple guys that, if they weren't careful, would have bumped their heads on the top of the dugout. So, you know, it was a lift for the team.
But when the series moved to Toronto, Chicago rallied behind Wilson Alvarez to win game three, then captured game four with four RBIs and a home run from Lance Johnson. On to game five, and a pressure-packed performance from Juan Guzman.
Pitch on the way, and a swing and a miss on a high fastball to get him. Guzman winds, a pitch, a swing and a miss. He struck him out.
Toronto 4, Chicago 1, Jackson, the tying run with two out in the top of the seventh. Guzman wins another battle.
Toronto won 5-3 to go up 3-2 in the series. It was time once again for Stewart.
Dave Stewart getting his mind set for his half of the first inning.
With most ball clubs, and I'm not afraid of them, but I respect them. And the White Sox ball club is a club that I have a lot of respect for. I think I carried more respect for them than they did for me in that situation, based on comments by Bo Jackson saying that he had seen my mother in a restaurant and said that they were gonna beat the mess out of me. But you know, when things like that happen, there's only one thing that's left to do is just go out and prove what you know how to do.
What Dave Stewart knows how to do is win in the postseason. And he laid the foundation for his 8th ALCS victory without a loss and his 2nd MVP award.
Ward comes set. The pitch, a swing, and a fly ball to right field. This is going to do it. Joe Carter's under it. He's got it, and the Blue Jays are going back to the World Series. They defeat the Chicago White Sox in Game 6 of the 1993 American League Championship Series.
The two-time defending National League champion Atlanta Braves stood in the way of Philadelphia's quest for its first pennant in 10 years. Here's Phillies pitcher, Curt Schilling.
Going into the postseason, it was the best team in baseball against a team that backed into the series. We didn't have a chance to beat that club. If you asked anybody but the guys in our clubhouse, it was a no-win situation for us. And we looked at it as, hey, we got nothing to lose. We're going to go out, and we're going to get dirty, and we're going to get bloody, and we're going to play as hard as we can for 7 games.
Wind up by Schilling, the 2-2 pitch. Bird called strike. Struck him out. 5 straight strikeouts to open the game for Curt Schilling.
I was in a situation I'd never been in before. I was nervous. I was anxious. I had to take a lot of deep breaths out there, but it was a situation that I dreamed all my life about, and I don't think I could have ever dreamed up a scenario like it turned out to be.
Schilling pitched 8 strong innings, struck out 10, and left with a 3-2 lead. On to the 9th, and on came Mitch Williams, the Philly closer, with 43 saves this year. In to play third base, defensive specialist Kim Batiste.
The 1-1 pitch. Swing ground ball to third. It might be 2. Wide throw by Batiste to right field. It's safe all around. And the Braves have runners at first and third. Nobody out here in the 9th inning.
The Phils would lose their 1-run lead, but they didn't lose faith in Batiste.
I, as well as everybody else on that club, felt for Kim because we know how important Kim was to this club and is to this club as a role player. I said at the beginning of the 10th inning that Kim was going to get the game-winning hit, and I didn't even know he was coming to the plate.
So here's Batiste with Kruk at second base and one out in the 10th. The 1-2 pitch. Swing, a hard ground ball. Base hit! Base hit! Down the left field line! Kruk scores! Phils win! 4-3 on the RBI hit by Kim Batiste! This place is going wild!
The quotes in the paper the next day from the Braves were that maybe we showed a little bit too much emotion in winning that ball game. But, you know, I think along with everyone else that, hey, this is the postseason. You dream your whole life about getting to this point. And to win a ball game in that matter, you know, it was just such an up and down moment that you couldn't help but be, you know, exuberant for him and for the club.
But in the next 2 games, Fred McGriff and the Braves bashed the exuberance right out of the Phillies, who were outscored 23-7. And lost both games convincingly. Trailing now 2-1, with 2 more in the chop shop of Atlanta Fulton County Stadium, no one really gave the Phillies much of a chance.
You know, no one said it, no one wanted to come out publicly, but being down 3-1 to the Atlanta Braves is almost like eliminating yourself. Our backs were against the wall being down 2-1 in their place, a club that hadn't lost 2 straight games in almost 2 months. So we knew what was at stake, and I think Danny Jackson pitched the guttiest game I'd have ever seen.
Jackson left in the eighth with a 2-1 lead and a hallowed place in Phillies history. He turned the game over to the up-and-down defense and the likewise up-and-down Mitch Williams.
Two men on base and two outs. Phillies lead by a run. One ball and no strikes to Lemke. Hands are on their feet now. Here's the stretch of the 1-0 pitch. Swing and a well-hit ball to left field. Thompson back. Leaps up and makes a great catch.
In the ninth, the spotlight turned to the defense once again, as Mitch giveth, and then Mitch and Batiste taketh away.
And the pitch gets the bunt down. Mitch Williams has it, throws the third. Great grab by Batiste. Nixon is the runner at second base. Clouser at first, and Ron Gamp the batter. Here's the pitch. Swing and a ground ball to second, might be a double play. Morandini tags the bag, double play. This game is over.
On to game five, where the Phillies turned to their commander-in-chief, Curt Schilling. Once again, Schilling was masterful, and the Philadelphia defense kept turning up in the most unexpected places. Until, that is, they moved to the bottom of the ninth. For with the Phillies leading 3-0, Batiste once again entered the game. And with a runner on first, he promptly made another error. The call went out for Williams. But which Mitch would we see? Four batters, a sacrifice fly, and three singles later, the game was tied at 3. Atlanta was going wild. And the winning run was 90 feet away with just one out. And contact hitter Mark Lemke at the plate.
I wasn't watching. I had my head down in the clubhouse. And I heard the fans scream, and then I heard a collective sigh.
Line down the left field line, foul ball!
And I heard Sean McDonough say, oh, just foul. And I thought, oh, God, we were inches away from possibly losing that series.
But Williams struck out Lemke and managed to escape the ninth. Then, in the 10th, Lenny Dykstra.
3-2 pitch, swing, and a well-hit ball to deep center field. Nixon back. It's out of here. Home run, Lenny Dykstra. And the Phillies have taken a 4-3 lead here in the 10th.
It was a lead that 40-year-old Larry Anderson would preserve to send the series back to Philly, with the Phillies holding an improbable 3-2 lead.
Being up 3-2 going into our place, facing the two best pitchers in baseball over the last couple years. We by no means thought it was over, but we knew we could beat them. And we came to the park that day, and we had a feeling and an air in the clubhouse that something special was going to happen.
Phillies are one out away from the National League pennant. Now the stretch. 3-2 pitch. Swing and a miss, struck him out. Phillies are the 93 National League champions. This wacky, wonderful bunch of throwbacks has won the National League pennant and go on to the World Series.
Presenting the 1993 World Series between the Philadelphia Phillies and the Toronto Blue Jays. With an unmasked sense of goodwill, the 90th World Series got underway in Toronto. The ball was in Curt Schilling's hands for game one, and the MVP of the NLCS was hoping to continue his postseason success. For Toronto, 14-game winner Juan Guzman took a 40-11 lifetime record into game one, but he ran into some first inning trouble courtesy of the Phillies leadoff hitter and spark plug, Lenny Dykstra.
The center fielder number 4, Lenny Dykstra.
Dykstra is ahead in the count, 3-1.
Yes! Get on base! He said he got on
base! Dykstra stole 37 bases during the regular season. He was only thrown out 12 times, and he's running with the pitch, which is a ball, Borders throw, gets by Alomar, and is backed up by Fernandez. So Lenny Dykstra has the first stolen base of the World Series, and he's in scoring position with nobody out of the first.
One out later, Dykstra's hustle paid dividends, thanks to the opposite field stroke of John Crump.
Line to left center and sinking fast, that falls in for a hit. Dykstra around to score, and the Phillies lead 1-0 on an opposite field single by John Kruk.
Guzman's shaky start continued when he walked Dave Hollins to put runners on first and second. Next up, Darren Dalton.
Go, Bubba! Let's go, Bubba! Woo! Come on, Darren!
The 1-2 pitch. Lined in a right for a hit. Carter kicked the ball in right. Kruk will be waved around by Bullock, and the Phillies lead 2-0.
A 2-0 Philadelphia lead for Schilling, one which lasted until the bottom of the second. For the Blue Jays had the top three hitters in the American League this year, not to mention Joe Carter, and they have a tendency to make some noise.
Up the middle, of base hit. That's the first Toronto hit.
Yeah!
Now John Olerud. In on the hands, but a base hit. Soft line single in the left. Now Paul Molitor. Pitch in the dirt. It got through Dalton, and the runners will move up.
Second and third! Second and third!
And now the tying run is at second base for Toronto in the second. Safe at first is Molitor. Carter scores the first Toronto run.
The Blue Jays will score once more on a fielder's choice to tie the game at 2. Each team added a run to make it 3-3. Then in the 5th, Roberto Alomar showed why he's being mentioned as a future Hall of Famer.
And that's a lob down the right field line, and a great catch by Alomar. The Gold Glover with a diving grab of the soft line drive over the head of Olerud. He was almost on the right field line when he made the catch.
That ball was real far away from me. And when I saw the ball, I thought I had no chance to catch it. But when I start running behind the ball, and I start kind of getting closer and closer, and I tell myself, I have a chance. So I dove, and I caught the ball, and I say, wow, this is incredible play.
And a crucial one, as Mariano Duncan followed with a triple off the left field wall, then scored on a wild pitch to put the Phillies up 4-3. The slim Philadelphia margin would be challenged once again in the bottom of the 5th. Devon White had hit 15 home runs this year, but rarely did he ever stop to watch them leave the field.
A bullet to right. Into the second deck and right for Devon White, a mammoth home run to tie the game at 4.
You don't hit too many of those, and when you do, sometimes you like to admire it, and I guess a little Ricky Henderson rubbed off on me, you know, seeing Fred McGriffin, those guys finishing high, and I didn't show any emotion or anything, but inside it was, you know, a thrill.
As Devo whipped the crowd into a frenzy, Schilling quietly reflected on the pitch. With the score now tied at 4, Al Leiter made his first World Series appearance in the top of the 6th. The Phillies promptly threatened, and the Blue Jays had to call upon their blue ribbon defense.
Runners at first and second with 2 down. 4-4 the score in the 6th inning. Here's Duncan. Leiter has given up 2 hits and a walk in the inning. Duncan up the middle. Alomar, great play to keep it in the infield. He lost the handle, but Stalker was diving back into third head first.
I knew I had a shot to knock the ball down. I don't know if I could have got the ball and throw the guy out, but I knew I kind of have a chance to knock the ball down and stop the guy on third base. And I'm glad that I did, because it stopped them from scoring a run, and it stopped them from getting a big rally in that inning.
With the bases now loaded and 2 men out, Leiter faced the turning point of the game. His mission? Neutralize John Kruk.
Put him down, Al! Put him down!
3-2 pitch and the bases loaded, 2 outs. All the runners will be off with the Leiter delivery. The runners go, and Kruk strikes out.
On to the bottom of the 6th, where the American League's leading hitter came up with 1 out, and John Olerud showed that for all his consistency, he could also go deep.
He hits that one down the right field line and deep, hooking toward the pole. Home run! John Olerud gives the Blue Jays their first lead of the night. It's 5-4 Toronto.
Final score was 8-5 as the Blue Jays took the all-important one-game lead. And for Al Leiter, what better way to remember this momentous game than backstage with his camera?
Al's first World Series win.
Mom.
Cheers.
Cheers, Al.
Cheers.
Just absolutely, this is it.
Oh, that's the game ball.
That's the game ball. The
ball that struck out Kruk. Kruk.
Yes. Kruk.
You know Kruk? Old John Kruk.
Game one, World Series, got the win. Beautiful.
With one game in the bag, the focus shifted to game two, where Dave Stewart took the mound for the Blue Jays. For the Phillies, it was Terry Mulholland, the 93 All-Star game starter, who was getting plenty of support from his number one fan, his father, Terry Mulholland Sr.
No, my son's pitching for the Phillies.
Really? Yeah. Yeah. Right now?
Terry Mulholland, yeah.
I knew this.
Yeah.
I knew there was something.
With the pitch, it was hard to tell who was more nervous, father or son.
Mulholland's first pitch skipped by Darren Dalton.
How nervous do you think he is? Yeah.
It's safe to say that everyone's nerves got a little worse when Henderson walked to open the first. But Phillies catcher Darren Dalton calmed his teammates down with a gun.
He is running. The pitch is strike, the throw, a good one. And Henderson is out.
All right. All right.
Terry had managed to escape the first inning unscathed. And in the stands, the countdown was on.
24 more outs.
In the top of the third, Stewart ran into trouble. The Phillies had runners on first and second with nobody out, and John Kruk was looking to do some damage.
Come on, Krucker! Little bingo, baby!
That's sinking fast in right center, and it falls for a hit. Dykstra round to score the first run of the ball game. The Phillies lead 1-0.
For Toronto fans, a momentary setback. But the worst was still to come, beginning with Hollins.
Hollins to shallow center. Hernandez can't get it. And Duncan is in with the second Philadelphia run.
The Phillies had taken a 2-0 lead for the second time in the series. And after Stewart retired Dalton, Jim Eisenreich stepped into the picture with a plan to make it more.
There was definitely a plan, and my plan was to not do what I'd been doing the last 2 months of the season, and that's not get the guy in from third with less than two outs. And so I was going to try to wait for a good pitch, and well, he got me 0-2 right away. I thought, well, just get it to the outfield, you know. Look for his forkball. That's what he's always thrown me in the past, try to strike me out with it. He ended up throwing a fastball a little high and in, and I don't know how I turned on it, but I did.
Fly ball to right, well hit. Carter sprinting back. It's over his head and over the fence. A three-run homer for Jim Eisenreich.
I clapped my hands coming around second, and I thought, geez, thanks. You know, that's the greatest thrill I've ever had. And it's that put us up 5-0, so that was a big plus for our game.
It wasn't till the bottom of the fourth that the Blue Jays staged a rally, with Molitor the catalyst. Next up, Joe Carter in a long ball state of mind.
Carter, a high fly to left. In Cavilla at the wall. And he can't get it. A towering two-run homer for Joe Carter that scraped the backside of the left field fence. And the Blue Jays are right back in it. It's 5-2.
One out later, Roberto Alomar looked to close the gap even more with a drive to deep left center.
That's well hit to center. Dykstra on the run, still going. And he makes a terrific leaping catch.
Never a doubt, never a doubt. Good play, Lemmy.
The game moved into the seventh with the Phils now leading 5-3. Up came Dykstra, whose knack for postseason success was becoming legendary. And against left-hander Tony Castillo, Lenny added just a bit more lore to his legend.
Dykstra. Home run into the Philadelphia bullpen.
Dykstra's seventh career postseason home run put the Phillies up now 6-3. But these Blue Jays weren't about to roost for the night. And in the bottom of the eighth, Paul Molitor once again struck the match.
Well hit, fair ball down the left field line. And Paul Molitor has a leadoff double.
Fregosi called on the Wild Thing, Mitch Williams, for his first appearance in a World Series. And even with a three-run lead, the unpredictability of Williams had the Phillies fans chomping at the bit, not to mention their nails. And for good reason, for with one out and a 1-1 count on Olerud, Molitor took off.
They let Molitor go to third without paying any attention to him.
It was tough to watch or listen to, as Molitor would score on a sacrifice fly to cut the Phillies' lead to 6-4.
You gotta expect at least one more guy to grab those.
Come on, Mitch.
That one more guy was Alomar, who had walked on a 3-2 pitch. Then with two strikes on Tony Fernandez, Alomar got a jump.
But he's running again, and no throw. Well, that's the second uncontested stolen base in the inning.
Usually with base runners, when they steal second, if they do it easily, they feel like they can get to third just as easily. And I just thought he might be running.
And now Williams steps off, and Alomar is out trying to steal third.
And that's a terrible play right there. Terrible.
It's a baseball axiom as old as the World Series. You simply don't get thrown out at third to end the inning. And no one felt worse than Alomar. On to the ninth inning, with the Phillies still leading 6-4. But Williams once again created trouble.
And ball four high. Williams walks the leadoff man on four pitches. He has faced three hitters in this outing and has walked two of them. And that brings the tying run to the plate for Toronto.
Representing the tying run, third baseman Ed Sprague, who in Game 2 of the 92 World Series had hit the game-winning home run.
A payoff pitch down to third. Batiste to second for one. Back to first, not in time. And Kim Batiste came very close to another postseason error.
It was, of course, too much to take. But with one out now and a runner on first, Williams opened the eyes and ears of Philadelphia fans everywhere against Blue Jays catcher Pat Borders.
A double play ball. Duncan turns it. And the World Series is even at one win apiece. Mitch Williams picks up the save with the usual flair for the dramatic in the ninth.
For the victorious Phillies, post-game congratulations were in order for the father of the winning pitcher. And as if the win wasn't enough, there was also a gift from Terry for his dad.
I had the lineup card. I said, here, you know, this is yours. I said, you know, this is yours to take home. That's his reminder of what it was like that night in Toronto.
Hi, babe.
Today is the 19th. This is the opening night at Veterans Stadium for Game 3. The games are tied up 1-1.
We're in
the Philadelphia Marriott. This room, it's kind of small, but I'm kind of happy with it. We have a nice view. That's the Schuylkill River.
Philadelphia is the home of Tasty Cakes.
Home of Tasty Cakes. We got nice
pretzels.
Couple of pretzels. Tasty Cakes.
And the city of brotherly love, they claim.
Yeah, but that's where Rocky runs up and down, right? Isn't that the museum?
Okay, straight ahead is the building.
Yeah, that's the Rocky building right there.
What is that?
But the most popular landmark in Philadelphia this day was Veterans Stadium. And at the vet, the talk of the town was Cito Gaston's decision to bench John Olerud, the American League's leading hitter, in favor of Molitor. It was Danny Jackson's first time back on the mound at Veterans Stadium since a late night pennant celebration left him and the city pumped up. But the only thing pumping in the first inning were the Blue Jays' legs, as Ricky Henderson led off with a single, and Devon White followed with a walk. The fear of every Phillies fan was realized soon enough, as Molitor silenced any and all critics of Cito's decision to sit Olerud right off the bat.
Sinking fast in right center and in for a hit, and on the wet turf, it scoots past Eisenreich to the wall. Henderson is in, Devon White is in, and Molitor has a triple.
Molitor helped Toronto take a 3-0 jump on the Phillies, the perfect formula for 19-game winner Pat Henkin. But Henkin ran into some first-inning trouble of his own as he faced Mariano Duncan after striking Dykstra out.
Base hit. And that's what the Phillies want to do, get the crowd back into the game.
And Kruk put the spotlight back on Molitor at first.
Base hit past Molitor. Duncan on his way to third. Carter overran the ball, and Kruk moves into second.
It was second and third and one out, and I really needed a strikeout there because the sac fly or ground ball is going to, you know, score a run. And, you know, we got a 3-run lead, and I go out and get myself in a jam right in the bottom of the first. Worst thing you can do. But fortunately, I got two strikes on him right away, and then I made a good quality pitch up and in with a fastball, and he swung through it.
The 1-2 to Holland. Strike three. He tied him up with the high inside fastball for the second out of the inning. Both have come via the strikeout.
The base hit scores 2 runs.
And Dutch, who drove in 105 runs during the regular season.
And I told myself, with an open base, I'm going to throw a high fastball, and if he takes it, I'm going to walk him and go after the next guy.
And many of the fans on their feet. The payoff pitch. He struck him out.
Oh, come on!
Having squandered a golden opportunity to score, the Phillies spent the rest of the night watching Molitor add to his Hall of Fame credentials.
That's well hit to left. And Cavilla watches it go. Home run, Paul Molitor. So playing first base agrees with Molitor, a 2-run triple in the first.
Molitor's heroics and Olerud's gracious understanding were the subplot to Toronto's 10-3 win. But with a 2-1 lead, Toronto also diffused any controversy over who's on first.
I just put my arm around John and said, hey, you know, for whatever reason, we're in this situation, this predicament, and thankfully, plan A has worked. I said, your turn tomorrow, let's make plan B be just as successful.
Plan B had Molitor at third base for game four, with Olerud back in the lineup at first. But for Phillies starting pitcher Tommy Green, it didn't much matter who was playing, for it was obvious that things were not going to go his way.
He walks Molitor on 4 pitches, and the Blue Jays lead 1-0. Well hit, base hit. White is in. Carter will score. And the Blue Jays, for the second straight night, have taken a 3-0 lead in the first. A 2-run single by Tony Fernandez.
But a funny thing happened to the Phillies in the bottom of the first. They patiently waited out 4 walks against Toronto starter Todd Stottlemyre. That made it 3-1. And with the bases loaded and 2 men out, it brought Milt Thompson to the plate.
2-2 with 2 outs and the bases loaded. 3-1 Toronto in the first. In the air to center, Devon White racing back at the wall. Can't get it. Hollins has scored. Dalton is in. Here comes Eisenreich. Thompson is at third, and the Phillies lead.
The Phillies had answered, and the back-to-back salvos were indeed a harbinger of things to come. Still, any momentum Philadelphia might have gathered disappeared in the top of the second, when Tommy Green somehow walked Stottlemyre, who was making his first major league at-bat. The base paths were virgin territory for Stottlemyre, something that became painfully evident two outs later.
Chopped up the middle, base hit. Stottlemyre around second, and he'll try for third after hesitating. Stalker's relay out at third. This is the most aggressive base running by an inexperienced base runner that you will ever see. The tag is hard, but it appeared that he scraped his chin going over the bag.
As I was approaching second base, I was slowing down and on my way to stop at second base, but I looked out to center field and seen Lenny, and I thought he was breaking it down, didn't expect me to go, and next thing I know, I'm taking off, and my jacket ballooned up full of air, and I looked over my shoulder to see if, you know, if he was throwing through or hitting the cutoff man, and when I seen him hit the cutoff man, I knew I was in trouble. So from there, and into the slide, and everything went black, and I don't have any idea what happened after that. All I remember was Cito saying that, get lighter up, and I remember shaking my head saying, no, I ain't coming out of the game.
Well, maybe he should have, as Todd, with a new look, returned the favor to Tommy Green. And although he did his best to keep his chin up, maybe Stottlemyre still wasn't all there. Lenny Dykstra, on the other hand, was.
Well hit down the right field line toward the pole. It is a home run. And in the case of the Phillies and his chin, Todd Stottlemyre can't do anything to stop the bleeding. 6-3 Philadelphia. And belatedly, the bullpen is up. Looks like Al Leiter throwing down there, but in my opinion, it's too late.
We're not as deep in the bullpen as people think. I mean, we pretty much went with 12 pitchers all year, and now we're going with 10. So we are not that deep since Danny Cox pitched the night before, and I didn't want Al Leiter to pitch too long. So we just had to suck it up and go back out there. I'm pretty sure that Jim Fegosi left Green in a little bit longer than he'd like to.
That was also true, as Green gave up two more runs in the third to make it a 6-5 Phillies lead. Fregosi summoned Roger Mason, who worked a bases-loaded two-out dilemma against Devon White.
Base hit. Butler will have a chance to score the go-ahead run, and he will as the throw goes to second. A two-run single for Devon White, and the Blue Jays reclaim the lead at 7-6.
It was now quite clear that no lead was safe as the two teams battled back and forth. The operative word here is battle, for that's precisely what this had become. At 7.
A bunt and a good one. Molitor, not in time.
Phillies catcher Darren Dalton.
Yes. Well hit down the right field line. Carter drifting toward the pole. Home run. A two-run homer, the Phillies are back on top, 9-7. And Eisenreich bunts the other way, a good bunt. Alomar can't make the play. Down the left field line, Milt Thompson has a hit. Eisenreich streaking toward third as Henderson plays it. He's waved around. Eisenreich will score. And the Phillies lead 10-7, a double for Milt Thompson. Was a drizzle all night, is now a very steady and significant rainfall. He's been on base all three times tonight. and has scored three times. He walked, stole second, and scored in the first, and a two-run homer in the second. Just missed a home run with a double off the wall and right in the fourth and scored again. And he hits one deep to right. Forget about it. Way out of here. What a night for Lenny Dykstra. His second home run. He's driven in four. He scored four times. And the Phillies lead 12-7.
Each team struck again. And with the score 13-9 in the seventh, Gaston made a most unusual move to open the inning.
And how about this? Tony Castillo is batting for himself.
Cito Gaston, all of a sudden his emphasis has shifted over to getting someone out, figuring that if you can't get him out, it doesn't matter how many runs that are scored.
You know, I think when Tony Castillo batted for himself there in the top of the seventh, and he was going to stay in the game, I think it was a situation where Cito wanted to save the bullpen. We thought that, you know, we'll look more towards tomorrow.
And tomorrow was inching ever closer, as the Phillies and their fans could sense that this was their game. This was their night. On to the eighth, and Toronto was in dire straits. Larry Anderson, in his second inning of work, got one out, then relinquished a walk to Olerud, following a single to Carter. The Blue Jays had life, and Paul Molitor.
The Blue Jays are in double figures. It's 14-10.
Number 99, Mitch Williams.
Base hit. Mitch Williams' fiance Irene. Three balls and one strike. And the tying run is at first for Toronto. The go-ahead run will come to the plate, and Ed Sprague is going to bat for the pitcher.
Classic moment for Ricky Henderson. 14-11, bases loaded, two men out.
The 1-1. Line to center, Dykstra can't get it. Two-run score, and the Blue Jays are within a run. It's 14-13. Ricky Henderson has silenced his critics in the last two games. Those are his first two runs batted in this World Series.
The Blue Jays were on the verge of erasing their second five-run deficit of the night. Now, Devon White looked to finish off the miracle comeback. And in the shell-shocked Philadelphia stands, one last hope that Williams would prevail.
Little looper, long run for Dykstra in right center, can't get it! Borders around with the tying run. Henderson to the plate with the go-ahead run. 15-14 Toronto.
It took so long for that ball to come down. And as soon as the ball hit the turf and bounced past him, we knew we were ahead because Ricky was on first base. And when that happened, you're talking about emotions. You cannot describe what was going on in that dugout. We say, hey, we've got a chance to win this ball game.
A really good chance in the ninth with Dwayne Ward on the mound, a closer who throws strikes, seeking to end a truly amazing game.
High fly to center. It'll stay in the park. Devon White makes the catch. And the Toronto Blue Jays have won the highest scoring game in postseason history.
An improbable comeback that gave Toronto the chance to win it all in Philly the next night. But first, a moment to put a remarkable World Series game in perspective.
Dave, have you ever seen anything as ugly as this?
It's ugly. It's a beautiful thing to me, man. Shoot, we came back, won that game 15-14. That's a beautiful ball game, man. Maybe not a well-pitched game, but a beautiful game.
Is it possible, Mitch, that all this stuff about hiding behind towels and watching you through...
Nothing is affecting me on the mound. That's all you people. It has nothing to do with the way I approach the game or the way I'm going to pitch. I don't care what anybody else does when I'm on the field. I go out there, I have a job to do. I try and do my job. If I don't do it, I'll come back tomorrow. But don't start trying to make excuses for me because I'm not looking for any.
As Philadelphia drowned its sorrows with painful recollections of what might have been, everyone was searching for answers to the longest and maybe the wackiest World Series game ever played.
It just wasn't a pretty game. I mean, not the way you picture a World Series to go. You know, you always dream of playing in a World Series, but then a game like that makes you wonder why.
The Phillies now trailed the series 3-1. And their last hope rested with the superhuman arm of Curt Schilling. But the team, its fans, and everyone else had to wonder just how long Schilling could go.
How do you plan to use Curt Schilling tonight? Are you going to let him go till his arm falls off?
Most likely.
But not only was Schilling being asked to risk life and limb, he also had to win. And catcher Darren Dalton did his best to keep his pitcher loose.
The more that I took the pressure off of Curt, you know, even before the game, you know, I came in and told a couple of our players, said, hey, you know, let's start riding Schill now, you know, just to let him know that the world's, all the weight of the world's not on his shoulders, even though it is.
Schilling's mission was to make like a Philadelphia pitcher of old. And with an early 2-0 lead, he did just that.
Pitch at strike three and a double play.
But Pat Borders singled to open the eighth, and Willie Cañate came on to pinch run. Fregosi's prophecy was coming true. He was sticking with Schilling till that arm did fall off. Or at the very least, till he saw what happened against pinch hitter Rob Butler.
There's a base hit. Cañate streaking toward third, and he'll get there as the throw is cut off. And the Toronto Blue Jays have the tying run at first base with nobody out in the eighth inning. And now Ricky Henderson.
I think what Jim Fregosi is saying, that unless the Blue Jays take the lead, Curt, it's up to you. It's all yours.
Off the glove of Schilling. He'll try the plate. Cañate in the rundown. Dalton. Now Hollins applies the tag. Cañate is out, and Butler did not move to third. So it's first and second for Toronto, and now one out in the eighth inning.
Schilling then struck out White for the second out of the inning. He was one out away from completing his most courageous inning all year. But he still had to face the amazing Alomar.
two outs, the situation still presents itself that if a hit is a run. I didn't have a lot left, but the crowd was on its feet, and it gave me, I think, the extra energy I needed to get through that at bat.
The next pitch will be the 30th of the eighth inning for Schilling. On the ground to second, Duncan throws him out. The Blue Jays leave two men on. They've stranded six. We go to the bottom of the eighth. 2-0 Philadelphia.
Now there was no question. This was Schilling's game. As the curtain opened on the ninth inning.
All I could think about was Carter, Olmstead, Molitor. Those were the three guys I was going to have to get out, not having my best stuff. I knew that I was going to have to pitch the ninth inning. And when I went out there and the bullpen wasn't up, I knew it was my game to win or lose.
Still throwing in the 90s, Schilling was superb. With a pop-up and a ground-out, Carter and Olerud fell by the wayside. The Blue Jays' last gasp was Molitor.
Line to center, Dykstra is there, and the Phillies win. A brilliant five-hit shutout for Curt Schilling.
The memories of 32 hits and 29 runs were gone in an instant. This was a World Series game. And now the series was going back to Toronto, thanks to Schilling. Back to Skydome, where Toronto sought to clinch, for the first time, a World Series on Canadian soil.
It's going to be Dave Stewart tonight up against Terry Mulholland.
Blue Jays fans were mad about their team and had no beef whatsoever about winning it at home. And in Dave Stewart, they had just the man to pull it off. The Phillies countered with Mulholland, still struggling somewhat following a late season injury. And with one out in the first, Terry walked Devon White, a move that begged for trouble, with Molitor thinking just right.
Mulholland basically the first game pitched me almost every pitch he threw me was away. And I knew that with the runner on first, I had a big hole to shoot for on the right side. Thankfully, I got a little bit more than that.
Molitor to right center, well hit. Eisenreich on the run, looking up, it's off the wall and a hop. White speeding toward third. He'll come around to score. Molitor into third with a triple. And the Blue Jays lead 1-0.
Good way to start because we're coming off of a shutout. We want to put some runs on the board early for Stu to work with, and sure enough, Joe comes with a sac fly. We get the double from Olerud and single from Alomar. Right back to another three-run first inning, something we did a few times in the series.
A few too many times if the Phillies had a say. But the three-run first inning had electrified the Skydome crowd, and they had their 14-carat pitcher on the mound, who, by the way, was shutting the Phillies down. Stewart held a 4-1 lead into the bottom of the fifth. And as the Blue Jays came to bat, a prophetic chant arose from the fans for their designated hero.
A designated hitter, number 19, Paul.
Okay, Paul! MVP! MVP! MVP!
Molitor reducing the likelihood of a game seven somewhat. With a tremendous blast into the second deck and left.
MVP! MVP!
They were chanting MVP very faintly in some sections of Skydome when he stepped in. That's a chant that might pick up some steam as Molitor takes his place in the dugout after his second home run of the World Series.
Mulholland was gone. Five innings, five runs, and the Phillies' hopes were growing increasingly dim. Then in the seventh, Stewart faced the bottom of the Philadelphia order. And in one of the series' great at-bats, rookie Kevin Stocker took Stewart to the limit.
Stocker battling Stewart. Another 3-2 pitch is ball four. Stocker was up there for 10 pitches. Stewart has now thrown 109. And the batter is Mickey Morandini. Line drive, base hit. Over the glove of Fernandez, cut off by Henderson. Stocker continues to third, and here come the Phillies. First and third, and nobody out.
He's got this uncanny ability to get himself out of jams. Oh, come on.
The center fielder, number four, Lenny Dykstra.
And it's uh-oh time for Blue Jays and their fans.
uh-oh is right. For Dykstra had shown an equally uncanny ability to come up with a postseason home run, seemingly at will. And if ever there was a time to lift his team off the ground, it was now.
Come on, Stu!
Well hit to right, way back, and that one is way out of here. Second deck home run for Lenny Dykstra. And all of a sudden, it's a one-run game, 5-4.
Dykstra's fourth home run of the series sent the spirits of Skydome plummeting to earth. What's more, it knocked Stewart from the game in favor of Danny Cox. But the Phillies were not done.
Duncan sinking past in center. The tying run is on for Philadelphia. 2-2 with Duncan running his ball three. The throw, safe. Tying run at second. Pulled count on Holland. The payoff there. Up the middle, a base hit. Duncan waved around and he will score.
5-1 and now we're 5-all.
Surprises me. You have two left-handed batters following Dalton. If you're not going to use Leiter now, why is he throwing?
I guess you're just playing a hunch. Cox. He's familiar with those guys, and the last time he faced him, if I'm not mistaken, he struck out three of them. I just wanted to go with Cox and see what happened. It didn't work out.
Oh, he walked them! I don't believe it!
That puts the go-ahead run in scoring position. High chopper could be a big problem. It will be. Everybody's safe. Bases full of Phillies with one out.
The Blue Jays fans had seen enough, and so had Cito, who called on the left-hander Al Leiter to pitch to Thompson. But Fregosi had a move of his own and countered with Big Pete Incaviglia.
Leiter pitching on his 28th birthday. And Incaviglia drives one to center, deep enough to bring the go-ahead run in for Philadelphia. Collins comes to the plate to make it 6-5 Phillies.
On to the eighth, which proved equally intense for the Phillies. Anderson came in with one man on and loaded the bases with two men out. Now, all he had to deal with was last year's series MVP, Pat Borders.
The 1-2 to Borders is a pop-up. Mickey Morandini wants it. And he makes the catch.
The unflagging spirit of Toronto fans was beginning to wane. But there was a bright spot to the eighth.
Well, at least we got top of the order up next inning.
The mini rally we had in the eighth inning was very good because it got us back to the top of the lineup. Had we not had that rally, then we probably would have been starting off with the number seven hitter instead of starting off with the number one hitter.
Maybe not the best number one hitter in this series, but certainly the best of all time. And just as the Blue Jays went with their best, so did the Phillies counter with theirs.
We knew that something, I don't know what it was going to happen. And when you know it, the very first pitch, he winds up, he's not looking, and the umpire calls timeout. The catcher runs one way, Ricky runs the other way, the umpire's running this away, and Mitch is ready to throw the ball home. And we said, hey, something's going to happen. We're going to come back and win this ball game.
Ball four. Williams walks Henderson on four pitches to open the ninth. A 3-2 pitch in the air, left center field. Incaviglia makes the running catch.
All right, that's one for us. That's one for us.
There you go. Let's go.
Come on, this is a big air, Mitch. Come on.
The biggest thing I was fighting was a natural thought process of hitting a two-run home run. As in the schoolyards, when you're playing, you know, you think about the home run that would win a World Series. And I knew if I hit a home run, we'd win the World Series. But that's not percentages. And so my biggest thing going up in that bat was, don't look for that one pitch to hit out of the park. Look for a pitch to hit hard to keep the inning going.
Line to center, falling fast, a hit. Third of the night for Molitor. Henderson stops at second. So the tying run is at second. The run that would win the World Series is at first, and Joe Carter is the batter.
Oh, I got a headache.
When I came to the ballpark, I told the guys, I told Ricky and I told Stu and Darnell Coles and half the team, I said, I've got my saddle on. I said, hop on. I felt this was going to be a tie.
Carter is 0 for his last seven. And he swung at ball three. Two balls and two strikes.
From my angle at first base, I could see that Dalton was only given one sign, which is kind of rare with a runner on second. I saw the changeup in the previous pitch, and Joe was out in front, and he swung at it. It was down from him. And then I saw that he was going to get a slider. And, I said, if he makes a mistake on this, Joe's got a chance to hit this ball good.
Now the 2-2. Well hit down the left field line. Way back and gone! Joe Carter with a three-run homer. The winners and still world champions, the Toronto Blue Jays.
I saw Dave Henderson hit his home run against the Angels. Kirby Puckett hit his home run against the Braves. And to see how their reactions are, you know, going to first base and everything, pumping fists in the air, that's what you live for in baseball. And I got that chance to kind of do one better. I mean, it was total pure joy.
This is the moment. This is the day. This is the moment when I know I'm on my way. Every endeavor I have made ever is coming into play. It's here and now, today. This is the moment. This is the hour. And I can open up tomorrow like a flower and put my hand to everything I plan to fulfill my grand design, see all my stars align. This is the moment, my final test.
Here's the pitch on the way, a swing and a belt. Left field, way back. Blue Jays win it.
The Blue Jays are World Series champions as Joe Carter hits a three-run home run in the ninth inning, and the Blue Jays have repeated as World Series champions. Touch them all, Joe. You'll never hit a bigger home run in your life.
The 2-2 pitch. Line drive to deep left. This ball is out of here. Three-run home run, Joe Carter. And the Toronto Blue Jays are the world champions of baseball for the second straight year. A three-run home run in the bottom of the ninth by Joe Carter, who's being mobbed at home plate.
Now the 2-2. Well hit down the left field.